Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now we're glad to see you here today. Appreciate you being here in the auditorium in the Northside Baptist Church. We welcome everyone. We have visitors. We're glad to have you. And always glad to see visitors come in and be with us here at Northside. Now you out in the radio listening audience, and most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Church here in Athens, Georgia. If you'll call a friend and have them to tune in and get this hour coming up, we'll try to be a blessing to them. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. So at this time, we'll turn the service over to Paul, the music director. And what he has lined up for us, I'm sure, will be a blessing to our hearts. So Paul will take over at this time.
Get your hymnal, turn to page 227. Hymnals again, turn to page 382. Sing the song title, I Would Not Be Denied.
Thank you.
Take your Bible and turn to Mark chapter 14, will you please? Next Sunday is Mother's Day. I want you to plan to be in God's house next Sunday and bring your mother if you can. And honor God and honor your mother next Lord's Day. Turn to page 1065 in the Scofield Reference Bible. Mark chapter 14. Now, the Lord willing, next Sunday, I'm going to give a little souvenir that I brought back from the Holy Land to the oldest and youngest mother that'll be present next Sunday. I have a little souvenir that I brought back from the Sea of Galilee over in the Holy Land. And some mother, two mothers, the oldest and youngest, will get these little souvenirs. So you keep that in mind for next Lord's Day. So you turn to Mark 14. Speaking about age and so forth, you know, our evangelist, when he was here, told us about this lady, 80 years old. She's having a lot of problems. And she went to the doctor. The doctor asked if she drank. She said, no. He said, well, do you smoke? No. Do you go out to parties? No. Well, I said, do you have any boyfriends? He said, yes, I got five boyfriends. You mean that you have five boyfriends? You're 80 years old? That's right. Well, said, how in the world do you get along with five boyfriends? He said, well, said, I usually get up early every morning with willpower. And then I go out and take a walk with old Arthritis. Then I come back in with old Charlie Horse. I sit around during the evening with old Lumbago. And then I go to bed with Ben Gay. Said that takes care of all five of them. And so I guess when you get up about 80, you can handle five boyfriends like that all right. Now I hope you have your Bibles open now at Mark chapter 14, beginning with verse 26. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. And Jesus saith unto them, all ye shall be offended because of me this night. For it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered. But after that I am risen, I will go before you into Galilee. But Peter said unto him, although all shall be offended, yet will not I. And Jesus saith unto him, verily I say unto thee, that this day, even in this night, before the cock crows thrice, thou shalt deny, before the cock crows twice, thou shalt deny me thrice. But he spake the word more vehemently, if I would die with thee, I will not deny thee in any wise. Likewise also said they all. Now I want to bring a message today on this line of thought, Simon Peter and Jesus. There's some many characteristics about Simon Peter that we can apply to our own hearts and lives. And I believe that if we are listening to the message today, we can be helped. About the only time that Simon Peter ever had his foot out of his mouth was when he would change feet. And so as we bring the message today, I want us to see ourselves in what happened to this man, Simon. Now, Simon Peter was never a pope. He was never in Rome, Italy, and the church is not built upon Simon Peter. The church is built upon Jesus Christ, the solid rock. Now, I've mentioned in times gone by how that Simon Peter is numbered with the number three. I might mention that again this morning before I get in the main body of my message. Now, Simon Peter's relationship to the number three in the Bible. First of all, he was one of the three in the inner circle, which included Peter, James, and John. Secondly, Simon Peter was a third to join Jesus. Number three, three times he was commanded to watch and pray. Number four, three times he went to sleep. Number five, three times he denied the Lord. Number six, three times the Lord asked, lovest thou me? Number seven, three times he confessed the Lord. Number eight, three times the Lord asked Peter to feed his sheep. Number nine, three times a vision appeared unto him on the housetop. Number 10, Three times the voice said, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." Number 11, three times he said, "Not so, Lord." Number 12, three men called for him. Number 13, the third day he went with the three and six, which is two threes. Number 14, Peter was three times in prison. Number 15, three times he escaped out of prison. Number 16, when he preached on the day of Pentecost, 3,000 people came to know God. Now we saw 16 different ways in which Simon Peter is connected with the number three. But there's several practical things I want to say about him today that can help us, I'm sure. We find, first of all, he was boasting in himself when he should have been trusting the Lord. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 35, Peter said unto him, Though I should die with thee, yet will I not deny thee. He's saying here, Lord, I would die before I'd ever deny you. I want you to know that. Oh, Simon Peter would die before he'd deny you, Lord. Here he was boasting about himself, talking about what he would do, instead of really trusting the Lord. Now you're still living in these Adamic bodies. You still face the devil every day. And don't brag too much about what you will do. You ought to say, by the help of God, and by the grace of God, and by the strength of God, and by wisdom from God, I won't do thus and thus. I've heard men stand up and testify the fact they'd never do this, they'd never do that. I heard a drunk one time after he'd made a profession of faith, he stood up and he said, "You're looking at a man right now that'll never touch another drop of liquor. I mean that. I'll never drink another drop." Before 2 months is up, he's drunk again. Now you need to say, by the help and strength of Almighty God, you won't do thus and thus. Now remember that. We find in the next place, he was sleeping when he should have been wide awake. In Luke chapter 26 and verse 40, "And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What could you not watch with me 1 hour?" Here we find Simon Peter sound asleep when he should have been wide awake. I believe there's ever a time when God's people need to be wide awake. It's in this hour in which we live. We're rushing toward the end. We're moving toward the end of this age. We're moving toward the rapture. None of us getting any younger. And if there's ever a time when we need to be awake and alert, it's during this hour in which we now live. Simon Peter was sound asleep when he should have been wide awake. But here we find him fighting when he should have been following the Lord. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 51, "And behold, one of them which were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck a servant of the high priest and smote off his ear." That man was Simon Peter. When they came to the garden to take Jesus and try him and crucify him, old Simon reached and grabbed his sword, and he aimed for the man's head. He meant to see that man's head jump off his shoulder. He meant to have killed the man that came for Jesus. He dared that man to lay his hands on the Son of God, and Simon came down with that sword, and Jesus caused the man evidently to move his head to the extent that instead of clipping his head off even with his shoulders, he only got his right ear. Now here's a man that is fighting when he ought to have been following the Lord. God didn't tell him to draw that sword and cut that man's ear off. In fact, Jesus told him to put his sword up. He said, "Put your sword up. This is no time to start a fight." And so he was fighting when he ought to have been following the Lord. We find in the next step, he was following afar off when he should have been treading in his master's footsteps. At this particular time, Simon Peter should have been treading right along in his master's footsteps. Instead of doing that, he was following afar off according to the Bible. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 58, "But Peter followed him afar off unto the high priest's palace, and went in and sat with the servants to see the end. Now, instead of walking right up near the Son of God, even close enough to talk to him and touch him, he was following afar off, way back, as far away as he could be from the Lord without losing complete sight of him. We have a lot of church members like that today. Men that one time walked with God, very close to God, had good fellowship with the Lord, loved the Word of God, loved the Bible, loved the house of God. But today they're walking afar, far away. They're going to get in trouble like Simon did. Just as certain as I'm speaking to you today, if at one time in your sojourn that you walked in fellowship with God, you got your prayers answered, you won souls to Jesus Christ, you supported the work of God financially and with your prayers, you were faithful in the house of God, and now you're walking afar off, you can rest assured there's a day coming when God's going to call your number. He'll certainly do that. And Simon Peter is following afar off when he should have been following in the Lord's footsteps. Then we come to the next thought, and that is, he was warming his hands at the fire of Christ's enemies when he should have been warming his heart at the sight of Christ's sorrows. Now here is a man. He finally goes into the hall after they carried Jesus in and then whipped him. And there they had to bruised him and beat his back and hit him in the face and plucked out his beard. And there Simon Peter eases in. It's cold weather. And they had a fire. The enemies of Jesus Christ had a little fire built there in the hall. And Simon Peter eases up to that fire and begins to warm himself and warm his hands at the devil's fire. Now, instead of warming his heart at the very sight of the Son of God and the presence of the Son of God, we find him warming his hands at the devil's fire. Now, there's a lot of church members like that today. Instead of being in the house of God, getting their hearts warmed by the preached word of God and by the singing and the fellowship and the praying, they're out somewhere carrying on in the world, warming their hands, as it were, at the devil's fire, when they ought to be warming in the fire of God, in the warmth of God, in the house of God. The place for God's people on Sunday morning is in the house of God, worshiping the Lord, getting your hearts warmed, getting in touch with God, getting revived and getting preached to by the minister from the Word of God. In Luke chapter 22 and verse 55, and when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the hall and were set down together, Peter sat down among them. So here said Simon Peter, one of the apostles, the man that bragged about what he would do and what he would not do, sitting down here around this fire with the devil's outfit. Now, if someone said you lie down with the dogs, you're going to get up with fleas on you. And so that's exactly what he was doing. He was sitting around there with the enemies of Jesus Christ. That's what happened to old Lot down in Sodom. He went down into Sodom, got involved in politics, became mayor of the place, and hobnob around with the devil's outfit. And there, of course, listened to the filthy conversation of the Sodomites and vexed his righteous soul. God's people's got no business hanging around with, hobnobbing around with the people of this world just to be going around with them. Amen. If you're going to carry them the gospel, if you're going to witness to them, that's a different matter. But to run with them, that's another matter. You began to run with the worldly crowd, the ungodly crowd, the cussing crowd, the liquor-drinking crowd, and the first thing you know, you'll be tempted and carried away with that crowd. The Bible said, run not with a multitude to do evil. And so Simon Peter sitting here, all of these people around this fire, no doubt they're cursing and talking about the Lord and criticizing them and running down the disciples and the apostles, and he's sitting right here warming his hands at the devil's fire when he should have been in the other room there very close to Jesus, warming his heart from the Son of God. But he was not. Now some of you church members right now out in the radio listening audience, you know as well as I know that you ought to be in the house of God. Now you know that. You ought to be in the house of God, warming your heart in the house of God. But instead, you're sitting at home. You have some little petty excuse that you've heisted up, which is not acceptable to God. God knows that you could have been in God's house if you wanted to. God knows that. And you're warming your hands at the devil's fire. Some of you right now getting that table set and getting the lunch ready, and you're real busy with your hands in the kitchen when you ought to be sitting in God's house with the Bible in those hands. You listen to me. You're warming your hands at the devil's fire when you ought to be in God's house, warming your heart in God's house by the word of God, and you know I'm telling you the truth. Then we come to the next stop, and that is he was denying what he should have been praying. In Luke chapter 22, verses 56 and 57, but a certain maid beheld him as he sat by the fire and earnestly looked on him and said, this man was also with him. And he denied him, said, woman, I know him not. Now here, O Simon Peter, the man that had bragged about he had never forsaken the Lord, he had gone to prison for Jesus, he would even die for Jesus, and here a little Jewish maiden scared him half to death when she pointed him out and said, he is one of them disciples. He is one of the apostles. I have seen him with Jesus. Oh, Simon Peter said, no, not me, little lady, not me. You're looking at the wrong man now. You're falsely accusing me, little lady. I know him not. Now here we find a big old robust fisherman, a man that had left his nets and followed Jesus for about 3 years, a little better. And now he's sitting here in the judgment hall denying that he knew the Lord. Now you never thought Simon would do that. Well, if you'd have told Simon Peter earlier, said, now, Simon, one of these days, a little Jewish maiden will face you, and she will point you out as being a follower of Jesus, and you go and deny that you even know the Lord. Well, you'd have had a fight on your hands. Well, man, you'd better got out of the way, because Simon Peter would have waited in on you if you'd accused him of that. Why, he said, well, you're a fool. He said, I'd go to jail for that man. I love Jesus. Not only that, he said, I'd die for him. And if you'd have told him he'd done this, you'd have most certainly had a fight on your hands, because he'd have flatly denied it, and he wouldn't have appreciated you telling him that he would have done it. He was denying when he should have been praying. Denying the Lord when he should have been praying, very much in prayer at this particular time. Then we come to our next thought, and that is he was cursing when he should have been witnessing. Now here is a man that has some curses in him, and he was cursing when he should have been witnessing. In Matthew chapter 26, verses 73 and 74, and after a while came unto him they that stood by and said to Peter, surely thou art also one of them, talking about one of the disciples or the apostles, for thy speech betrayeth thee. Then began he to curse and to swear, saying, I know not the man. Now you never dream that this war horse of God, this mighty fisherman, this apostle, this great man that God had called from the fishing business to follow him, you never dreamed that he would start cursing. And yet he started cursing when he denied the Lord. Of course, denying the Lord wasn't enough. He thought, well, they still going to think I might be one of them. So he said, I'm just going to start cursing away, and blankety blank blank, he started cursing right there in their presence. He said, if they hear me curse, then they will know I am not one of his disciples or one of his apostles. And he started cursing. Can you imagine this man doing that thing? The Bible says the enemies take God's name in vain. People today have a lack of a vocabulary when they use four-letter words and take God's name in vain. They're trying to impress somebody. They're trying to act manly when they're really not. When a person is constantly taking God's name in vain, constantly using four-letter words, while that man has a real lack of vocabulary, that man don't have anything to say, and he's got to blankety blank blank this and that, because he's trying to impress somebody. To curse and take God's name in vain is not manly at all. That's cowardly. It takes a real person with a real backbone to never take God's name in vain and not to use four-letter words. The whole world today has gone down the broad road toward destruction on the use of four-letter words. I was reading the other day, I believe, in the U.S. News and World Report, how that all over this world, people are cursing more, taking God's name in vain, and more using curse words and four-letter words, and becoming more and more common. There used to be a day when you never heard a woman curse, take God's name in vain, or use filthy language. But they tell me, you get around a bunch of women now that's maybe work in a certain place and get in a certain place, and you can hear some of the most foul language that ever come out of the lips or mouth of any person. And that's sad. It's a sad day when women curse and use four-letter words and use foul language like a bunch of wicked and ungodly men. They should not do it, neither should the men. And here we find Simon Peter cursing when he should have been witnessing. Then we find in the next place, while his heart was right, his methods were wrong. Now Simon Peter, deep down in his heart, he loved the Lord. Deep down in his heart, he knew God. Now if you're saved, in your heart you know God. Deep down in your heart, you can say, well, I love the Lord. But if you're not careful, you let your methods go wrong. And you be saying or doing things that you should not do. That's exactly what Simon Peter did. While his heart was right, his methods were wrong. He used the wrong methods many times when he should not. For instance, when he cut the man's ear off. Simon's heart was right. He loved the Lord. He wanted to defend the Lord in that manner, but that was a wrong way to do it. And so instead of praying for the man, he wants to get in a fight with him and cut his head off. Then we find again that the look of the Lord broke his heart and unsealed the fountain of his tears. I want to take a verse or two and show you that he had a humble heart. He had a good heart, a gracious heart in him, but he had made these mistakes. Now in Luke chapter 22, verses 61 and 62, and the Lord turned and looked upon Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord. How he said unto him, before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. And the Bible said, and Peter went out and wept bitterly. Here you find this big old giant of a man, after cursing, after denying the Lord, after wanting to cut a man's head off. Now he hears a rooster crow. And when that rooster crowed, it reminded, he remembered, that Jesus said, now Simon, listen, before that rooster crows twice, you're going to deny me three times. And when that rooster crowed, Simon Peter remembered what Jesus said, and the Bible said he went out and wept bitterly. Now the weeping bitterly here means, in the original Greek, that when he went out, his whole body began to shake in sobs. That man was squalling. He was crying. And somebody said he was yelling. He was really crying out loud. I mean, they could hear him all around the place crying. He was so upset and so shaken because of what he had done. He just cried and shook and wept bitterly. Wept bitterly. Tears rolled down his face because he realized what he had done. That shows you there that deep down in his heart, it was genuine. And he loved the Lord. Although he had made these mistakes, he was genuine in his heart, and he wept bitterly. And when, what caused him to do so? There he looked at Jesus, and he heard the rooster crow, and he saw the suffering of his Lord, and he knew what he's done. And then we find in the next place that the bitterness of his tears revealed the real sweetness of his heart. The very fact he shed the bitter tears revealed the sweetness of his heart on the inside. Now, Simon Peter loved the Lord, no doubt about that. And here it really broke his heart when he realized what he had done. Then finally, he went out into the night of repentance and came back in the morning of resurrection. He went out and repented and came back in fellowship with God. When Jesus Christ rose from the dead, Jesus knew Simon's aching heart. And Jesus knew Simon had wept and lost sleepless hours over what he had done. And the Bible said that Jesus appeared unto Simon. The Son of God, knowing he had a broken heart and a grieved heart, and knowing that Simon would like to talk to him personally about it, Jesus made a special trip to talk personally with Simon Peter after his resurrection. Wouldn't you like to have heard what was said? I believe when Jesus walked up to Simon and Simon recognized his Lord, I believe he reached and put his arms around him and kissed him on his neck and said, "Lord, I'm so sorry that I did what I did." And I believe he began to weep and said, I wish I hadn't have done it, Lord. I really didn't mean to do what I did, Lord. I don't know why I did it." And there Jesus, no doubt, had him on the back and said, "Simon, you have been forgiven now. You have been changed or converted. Now what you need to do is go strengthen your brethren. Go, Simon, and feed my sheep. Simon, I want you to go and feed my little lambs." On the day of Pentecost, Simon Peter stood up, faced that howling mob that crucified Jesus. This is after he was filled with the Holy Ghost. A little woman scared him half to death before then. But after he was filled with the Holy Ghost, he stood there as bold as a lion. He pointed his big old finger at those Jews, and he said, "You have crucified the Prince of Life. You have killed the Lord of Glory. With your wicked hands, you have crucified Jesus Christ, your Messiah." And they were cut to their hearts. And they said, "Men and brethren, what shall we do? If we are guilty of that, what shall we do?" Simon Peter told him, "Repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved and to be baptized." Oh, Simon now was a different man. And tradition tells us, not the Bible, but tradition tells us that when Simon Peter came to die, now Jesus did tell him how he would die. He knew how he was going to die. He knew he was going to be crucified. That's very clear in the last chapter of the Gospel of John, also in 2 Peter, the first chapter. He knew how he was going to die. And he knew he would die. He knew the Lord would not come in his lifetime. He knew that. And then before he died, he knew he'd be crucified. Jesus told him that in the last chapter of the Gospel of John. He'd be crucified. His hands would be stretched out and so forth. Now, he knew he was going to die. And this is his request. Tradition tells us that when they brought Simon Peter out to the cross to nail him on the cross, he looked at that old rugged cross and he said, "People, could I have one request before I die?" They said, "What is your request, man?" He said, "Would you crucify me with my feet up in the air and my head toward the ground?" They said, "Why you want to be crucified like that? That's more horrible than ordinary crucifixion." He said, "I'm not worthy to be crucified like my Lord. Crucify me with my feet in the air and my head toward the ground." And tradition tells us that's exactly the way they crucified Simon Peter. Let's stand to our feet. Father, I pray today that you'll take the message and that you'll use it, that you speak to hearts. God, so many of us are like old Simon. We make mistakes. But deep down in our hearts, Lord, we love you. And we pray that you'll help us all in this respect. Father, speak to the people here in the auditorium as well as those in the radio listen audience. I do pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now listen to me. The ladies are going to play on the instruments as they play. If you're here unsaved, backslidden, you want to come forward for any reason, you want to join the church, if you have a need of any kind, you want to come down here for help, I want you to come right down here, let me help you while they play a couple of stanzas. Come on now, if God is speaking, would you like to join the church? Do you need a church home? Would you like to come back to God? Would you like to get saved? This is your opportune time to respond. Now would you come? Just a moment, we're going. We'll help you if we can.